Good morning. Welcome to St. John's Church. Welcome to anybody who's joining us from elsewhere. We trust that you'll be blessed as we gather together to worship the Lord. Let me begin with an opening prayer, and then we'll stand to say some responses and carry on with an opening hymn. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are delighted to receive your people's praise. Thank you that you know our hearts and our circumstances of life. We pray for one another if we have come in carrying burdens, and we ask that we would be able to leave them at your feet. We thank you if we have come in with cheerful hearts. We pray that we would give you the praise and thanksgiving. We ask that you would bind us together as one family, that we may lift your name high. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you like to stand and we'll join in these opening responses? Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
There is no end to his greatness.
One generation shall praise your works to another. All your works praise you, Lord.
And your faithful servants bless you.
They make known the glory of your kingdom.
And speak of your power.
My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord.
Let everything bless his holy name,
forever and ever.
Hallelujah, sing to Jesus.
Jesus, out of every nation have redeemed us by his blood. By his death on the cross, we have forgiveness of our sin, we are reconciled to God, and we inherit all his promises. So let's take a moment just to be quiet before we join in some words of confession together, to just personally reflect. We confess our sins, confident that God is always ready to forgive us. Join in saying, forgive me my sins, O Lord. Forgive me the sins of my youth and the sins of my age, the sins of my soul and the sins of my body, my secret and my whispering sins, my presumptuous and my crying sins, the sins I have done to please myself, and the sins I have done to please others. Forgive me the sins which I know, and those sins which I know not. Forgive them, O Lord. Forgive them all out of your great goodness. Amen. And so hear this prayer of assurance. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and lead us in life eternal. Amen. We continue with some intercessory prayer. The response to Lord, in your mercy, is hear our prayer. I'm going to pray today about the media. All of us get our news, usually, either from the television or through modern social stuff, through the internet, or through what we hear publicly. God calls us in his word to pray for those who are in leadership, that we may live quietly and peaceably. And yet, so often, those involved in journalism are not simply reporting the truth or making things known, but have political agendas and purposes, and we can't be clear about what we hear or read. And the news can make things more fearful, whether it's international affairs and the possibility of war, or whether it's health matters. The media can stir up anxiety through the misuse of statistics and the headlines that are prepared. So, loving Heavenly Father, we pray for all those who are involved in journalism of any sort and through any media. We ask for honesty and clarity. We pray against the misuse of information or the deliberate lies that may be portrayed. We ask for conversations to happen fairly. We pray that the media may be an instrument that helps us live together rather than divides us. Lord, in your mercy. Father, we acknowledge that your church does not have a good press. It is either completely ignored, or the only thing reported is division or scandal or irreverence. Father, we continue to pray for those who do have a public voice for you, and we ask that you would give them clarity of expression, and we ask that they may be reported fairly and their words not twisted. We pray that the good news of the gospel may be proclaimed so that people may come to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, we pray for those who are in particular anxious about their health and safety in these days, and for the information that is given. We ask that figures that are used and words that are said may help people to be less in fear rather than more. And in a moment of quiet, we lift to you any individuals who are known to us who may be anxious at this time. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We're going to continue in praise together, but the first, we're singing two songs, one after the other. The second one we'll be very familiar with. The opening song is a new song of worship, so just stay seated for the moment, and the music group are going to sing through a verse and a chorus, and then we'll stand and go back to the beginning and sing it together with them, okay?
safety here at the shore. Beyond the horizon, I see there is so much more. Take this bucket full of faith. It is all I have today. I'm giving it all. I'm giving it all. You will always have
Please be seated. Normally we'd say a prayer, but we're going to say a prayer after we've had the reading, and before the reading we're going to look at a poem. So here's a poem by Emily Dickinson, and we're just going to go through some. She's not always easy to follow if you're into poetry at all, and Emily Dickinson doesn't always make sense, so we're going through it a little bit. You have to imagine a wall falling down, or a wall suddenly collapsing. Okay, you've seen something fall down instantly, as it were. So here's her opening. Crumbling is not an instant act of fundamental pause. So what she's saying there is, it doesn't just happen like that. Then we get this. Dilapidation's processes are organized decays. In other words, something has planned it, if you like, or something has happened before, leading to the collapse. Here's the second verse. 'Tis first a cobweb on the soul that tells us that she's now switching to talking about not the collapse of a wall, but the collapse of a person. And it begins with just a little cobweb. It begins with just a cuticle of dust. A little bit. It begins with a borer in the axis. In other words, a worm that's making its way through an apple. All of these are small things. An elemental rust. A little bit of rust that's just there, if you like, in the corner. So the whole point of that second verse is picking up the first verse, which saying it's not something that just happens like that. It's a process over time, and the starting bits are small. And then we go on to a third verse. Ruin is formal. Devil's work. Hardly anybody is going to be brought down just like that. Actually, the devil is an organized decayer, and little bit by little bit will build up. Then we have this, consecutive and slow. Then this, fail in an instant, no man did. And the last line, slipping is crash's law, i.e. there's a process like that. You don't just... So that's a poem just talking about something completely crumbling, starting with a physical thing, if you like, a wall collapsing, but going on to people. And her basic point is that it's a slow process, something's going on with almost an insignificant beginning, but actually wearing away all the time. I'm sharing that with you because I think it may help us at the end of the sermon, but this is not God's word, it's a poem, but we can find help from all sorts of places, and you might just help that imagery helpful, because we're going to read a passage about very graphic and total ruin from Numbers chapter 25. Now, the people of Israel are still camped opposite Jericho in the plains of Moab. Balaam, who will appear in this reading, has not cursed them, because God has told him to only speak blessing on the people of Israel. Nevertheless, here's what happens next. While Israel remained at Shittim, the people began to play the harlot with the daughters of Moab, for they invited the people to the sacrifices of their gods. And the people ate and bowed down to their gods. So Israel joined themselves to Baal of Peor, and the Lord was angry against Israel. The Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders of the people and execute them in broad daylight before the Lord, so that the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away from Israel. So Moses said to the judges of Israel, each of you slay his men who have joined themselves to Baal of Peor. Then behold, one of the sons of Israel came and brought to his relatives a Midianite woman in the sight of Moses and in the sight of all the congregation of the sons of Israel while they were weeping at the doorway of the tent of meeting. When Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, saw it, he arose from the midst of the congregation and took a spear in his hand. And he went after the man of Israel into the tent and pierced both of them through, the man of Israel and the woman, through the body. So the plague on the sons of Israel was checked. Those who died by the plague were 24,000. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, has turned away my wrath from the sons of Israel, in that he was jealous with my jealousy among them, so that I did not destroy the sons of Israel in my jealousy. Therefore, say, behold, I give him my covenant of peace, and it shall be for him and his descendants after him a covenant of a perpetual priesthood, because he was jealous for his God and made atonement for the sons of Israel. Now the name of the slain man of Israel who was slain with the Midianite woman was Zimri, the son of Salu, a leader of a father's household amongst the Simeonites. The name of the Midianite woman who was slain was Cozbi, the daughter of Zur, who was head of the people of a father's household in Midian. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, be hostile to the Midianites and strike them, for they have been hostile to you with their tricks with which they have deceived you in the affair of Peor and the affair of Cozbi, the daughter of the leader of Midian, their sister who was slain on the day of the plague because of Peor. And then in Numbers 31, we read, behold, these women of Midian caused the sons of Israel through the counsel of Balaam to trespass against the Lord in the matter of Peor. So the plague was among the congregation of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the gift of Holy Scripture, which is written, the Apostle Paul has told us, for our learning. So we ask that we would learn from your word this morning, that it may be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So I think in the passage we have there a great warning and a great example. We're meant to heed the warning and follow the example. So we're going to look at the warning and the example, and then we're going to ask a question about how. How does a disaster happen, and how does such zealous activity for God come about? You do need to picture the camp of the Israelites in order to get this story, if you like. There's a lot of them, remember. We know there's a lot of them because there's a census coming up which tells us how many people were there who were soldiers, men of age in which to fight, adult men. There's 600,000 of them. Almost all of them are going to be married, so that's double that, obviously, and almost all of them are going to have children. So I think that actually 2 million is a kind of minimum estimate of the people of Israel camped in the plains opposite Jericho. And the camp is very well organized. It's got to be well organized with that number of people, hasn't it? And there are actually other chapters in the Bible which tell us in some detail how the camp was organized. What you need to know for the purposes of this story is that in the middle of all of them is an enclosure area with a tent in it in which the Ark of the Covenant is placed. So that's an open enclosure in the sense that there's tented stuff around it, and then in the middle of it there's a tent with a covering, and in that is the Ark. That's in the middle. So imagine it has four sides. Then all the other tribes are told where to camp. So roughly speaking, there's 500,000 people that way, 500,000 people this way, 500,000 people that way, and 500,000 people that way. So between you at the back here and them at the back there, there's a million people. So obviously stuff is going on around the camp that not everybody knows or sees. And then around this camp are the tribes of the area in which they've kind of come. They're refugees from Egypt. Well, there are already other people living in these places. And all of these other people are nomadic pasturers. They're keeping animals, basically. And it's not like today with borders of nation states. You don't kind of go through a barrier or, you know, somebody whether you've got to wave your passport at to go across from France to Germany, or well, you haven't got to do that, have you? But anyway, just imagine it, that kind of thing. There aren't those borders. There are no borders. So what you've got is a kind of intermingling of lots of different tribal groups of people. There's the Midianites, the Amalekites, the children of the east, the Ammonites, the Moabites, and other ones. So you've got these tribal groups of people all living around in the area. There are no national boundaries. And these people are there before the Jews come out of Egypt. You need to picture that. All these other groups worship the same God, who is called Baal, B-A-A-L, all of them. Baal is the predominant god, with a small g, being worshipped throughout all this area. And he's a god, we might say, of course, of fertility. If your whole livelihood depends on the weather and on the crops, then you need a God who's in control of the rain and the storms and the sun and all that kind of thing, because otherwise the crops will fail. And if they fail, you'll die. So Baal is a god of fertility. But not only is a god of fertility of crops, he's also the god of fertility of people. Because, of course, if you don't have children, more than two, your tribe will become stagnant or die out. So Baal is a god of fertility. And they would make carved statues or stone, you know, stuff, to symbolize Baal. All of these people who live around. If you were here last week, Balaam is going home. He's left the mountains of around the Dead Sea and heading east. It's going to take him some time, and he's not traveling along the tops of mountains, he's in the valleys. And as he's going out, clearly, some of the Moabites and the Midianites say, "What are we supposed to do with these people?" I mean, he hasn't cursed them. He hasn't taken the money of the king. What are we supposed to do? They're all here in our land. And so Balaam says, invite them to a party. Invite them to a party where you're worshipping your God. Send the women in. And that's what they do. And they go down and they say, come and join the party. And they go. At which point, we all need to remember the second commandment. Now, I don't know about you, but remembering the commandments at all 10 of them, could you do that in your head very quickly? No, just leave it alone. Could you do them in the right order? A lady came up to me just outside the vicarage in Lambeth and just said, what's the second commandment? What's the second commandment? In a panic. And I'm going, oh, what's the second commandment? I don't know, what is the second commandment? And of course, most of the commandments are only one line. But two of them are much longer. The one about the Sabbath day, perhaps we ought to note that. And the second commandment is, you shall not make any graven image, not in the likeness of anything. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. That's the second commandment. You shall not make any graven image. And along come these women and say, come to the party. And the party involves wine, women, and song. And it's a great time. There's lots of sex, because of course it's all about fertility. And there are lots of sacred prostitutes that live in these shrines. And the people of Israel go, enticed. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 13, in the Amplified Version, talks about the deceitful glamour of sin. It looks good. There's nothing wrong with it. Let's go. And in this, there's an awful warning for us. It's 1 month short of crossing the river. 1 month. The milk and honey is on the other side of the river. The promised land is on the other side of the river. The place they're supposed to get to is the other side of the river. And for goodness sake, they've been going for 38 years through the desert. We're going to cross soon. And you can get right up to the borders of the river and not get across, because the deceitful glamour of sin has ensnared you. What are we to do? We'll come back to that. There's also an example of zealousness. Would you call yourself zealous for God? The rabbis rank people in the Old Testament. And of course, number one at the top by far is Moses. Number two is his brother Aaron. And number three is his great nephew Phinehas. And that's when you need to remember the layout of the camp. Because, of course, the worship to this god Baal over there is at the far end, out of the way. In fact, it's not in the camp at all. They've gone out of the camp to the worship. But into the camp and right into the middle comes a guy with one of these women and goes into his tent while the people of Israel are weeping at the tent of meeting. And Phinehas gets a spear and he goes in, and in the act of them being joined together in sex, he puts a spear through both of them in one go. And he is praised by God. What a great man who was zealous for the honor of God. And it's because of him that the plague is stopped and more people don't die. Zealous. Zeal for God. Have you got it? Most of us would probably say we're kind of chugging along or going along, or we sometimes do something a bit special, but how many of us would actually say, I am zealous for God, for the honor of his name? And Phinehas does this gruesome, remarkable act, for which he is number three of all the people in the Old Testament. Jesus describes himself as zealous. In John chapter 2, so that's very early on, isn't it? He does something. In chapter 1, all we've had, if you like, is an introductory bit with those words, you know, in the beginning was the Word and lovely stuff. And then there's John the Baptist, and then there's the calling of a few disciples. Jesus doesn't really do anything until chapter 2. And what he does is this. He makes himself a whip. And with this whip, he goes into the crowd of people in public, in the temple area, and uses it. He flays people and tables and things. He overturns everything. He scatters all the money and tells them to get out. How dare you make my Father's house, which is meant to be a house of prayer, a house of this commercial exercise. He uses the whip on people. And then he says these words, zeal for your house, meaning God his Father, has consumed me. Zealous for God his Father, to the extent of making and using a whip. How can we imitate zealousness and avoid disastrous falling? And that's where we come back to the poem. What was Jesus doing for the 18 years prior to this first public act? We're only told one verse, but it tells us that he grew in spirit and in physical stature, grew up, and in obedience to his parents. How was he able to quote, zeal for your house has consumed me? He didn't stand there with a Bible and flip through it and look it up. He hasn't got such a thing. But for the previous 18 years, he's been learning. For the previous 18 years, he has been so close to his Father and praying with him that he knows exactly what his Father wants. It was a day by day by day by day, bit by bit by bit by bit, praying, reading closer. Praying, reading closer. And the way we fall is by not doing that bit by bit and step by step, little by little bit. I don't read my Bible today. Does that really matter? Well, it's a step away, and it's the first one. I don't do my prayers today. Does it really matter? Well, it's a step away, and it's the first one. Here's a frightening statistic. A survey was carried out about church worship this year now, last year, and the year before. The conclusion is that in most churches throughout Britain, the attendance at church today is 20% less than it was before COVID started. And we can tell that by looking around. 20% less. And what was the main reason given for not attending? Answer, I got out of the habit of going. I got out of the habit. I got out of the habit of saying my prayers. I got out of the habit of reading my Bible. I got out of the habit of going to church. And for goodness sake, going once is surely enough. Well, brothers and sisters, if you want to be somebody who is ready to be zealous for God, it's that step by step away or step by step closer. Every step counts one way or the other. And we need to be aware that we have to cross the river. Thanks be to God for his word. Amen. Are you giving this notice out, or are you giving a notice out? Come along and be bright and cheerful and happy, and invite everybody along to a bacon butty that will keep us closer to God next week.
Closer to God. Next week it's the butty breakfast. If you haven't signed up and would like to join us, there's a list at the back that would be really helpful to know how many people are coming. It starts at 10 o'clock. We're in the church hall. Come and join us for a cup of tea and a bacon sarnie before church. Thank you.
Could come to church next Sunday morning after the bacon butty, and you could read your Bible every day in between and say your prayers. And in the meantime, we can stand and worship God together. Would you like to stand?
Christ, my living hope.
Loving Lord Jesus, we praise you that you are our living hope. Thank you that you have broken every chain and called us to your side. Fill us, we pray, with your Spirit. Enable us to walk in your paths. Help us to be zealous, we ask, for the honor of your name, not because of our strength, but because of yours. Not for our glory, but for yours. In your name we pray. Amen. Brothers and sisters, go in peace to love and serve the Lord.